across Australia, there are many, many different Aboriginal groups of people, some who define by their language. And we know that there's 400 to 600 or more languages that were once in Australia. There's quite a number of them that are still actively spoken as a first language. Where I speak from is mostly influenced by the areas of country where I've worked. So I haven't had experience in coastal environments where Aboriginal groups are using their country or in the Torres Strait. But I think it's really important to acknowledge and recognise that their practices there are unique to them. From an archaeological perspective, Aboriginal people have occupied Australia for at least 50,000 years. So that's 50,000 years of burning, of manipulating water sources, of hunting, and affecting the landscape through other tools and ways, the landscape and the species within it. And then from Aboriginal perspectives, the care is manifested through people's relationship through Jukurrpa, and that, or dreaming, or the laws of the country. There's no direct translation of care, but there is within a number of, certainly desert cultures, a term that for the Western Desert side is called kanyinapa, which means to hold, but also to be held by. So there's this sense of a reciprocal relation between people and place. The word biodiversity is an unfamiliar one to many people. Within Aboriginal languages, to what I'm familiar with, there's no direct translations of the word biodiversity, but there are translations of words which have a sort of conceptual similarity. There's a term, Anpernirrentye, which talks about the relatedness between all things. And so it's a term that brings together people and species and Jukurrpa and country, and it is focused on the interconnections between those. And there's similar terms we know from other Aboriginal languages. Well, those things that make up biodiversity, you know, from what I hear, are important to very many Aboriginal people, a surprising number, of including people who live in urban city contexts. Where that comes from is people's entire economy and lives was directly reliant on eating the plants and the animals and finding the waters and using the resources of the landscape for their food, for their medicine. So it was the bush supermarket, the bush pharmacy, the hardware shop, all those different resources had to be gathered. And so it was part of people's health, their economy. It is also a focus of people's personal identity. Here's a really good example of where biodiversity is important to people. So I'm sitting here next to a forkleaf corkwood. Now this one tree has within it at least 5 different values where it's useful to local people. There's a flower which is a source of nectar for people. So that flower is sucked or dipped into water to make a fermented drink. There's the follicles of the tree, which were used as play items by kids. They've got very dense black charcoal on the bark, and that's used as a medicine for skin conditions. Shade's a really critical resource, and it provides really dense shade. It's a habitat for a number of animals that are hunted by people. So it's got these sort of multiple uses within the one plant that then connect it to people and connect it to other species. How people monitor biodiversity and changes over time is through accumulated long-term observations, lifelong observations. The state or condition of plants or animals is a really common topic of discussion day to day. You know, as we might sit around the breakfast table and talk about the weather for the day, Arunda people might sit around and look at what the ants are doing and what that tells them about the weather for that day. So there's daily observations that, which are part of everyday conversation, and then there's remembered observations that sort of track back over time, and then there's knowledge which is accumulated from people, from their grandparents and parents, which accumulates across generations. And then people travel a lot, and so they're accumulating observations over space as well, and seeing land in different states and conditions. So in this country, we've had a rapid proliferation of the weed buffalo grass in the last 20 years. And many people would grow up just seeing buffalo as a normal part of the landscape, unless they go out with older people from whom they hear the stories of how it was otherwise, how there was a much wider diversity of plants than just this new plant, this stranger plant that's come. So there's a range of impacts upon Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people from biodiversity decline that's caused by invasive species and other threatening processes. And worldwide, Indigenous people are some of the first people to be impacted and affected by declines in species, because it's very often those people who are subsisting on those local resources, and as they decline, they're experiencing food shortages, can't find the particular medicines they want. There's a shortage of the timber artifacts they need to make tools. So for Australian Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, the scarcities are felt first and foremost. I think it's recognised that Aboriginal people, through their long residency, through their multiple connections to a particular place, and through their commitments to supporting younger children, want to play a part in natural resource management, species management, biodiversity management. In my experience, lots of Aboriginal people are really keen to learn about well-presented, clear, accessible science ways. And I think increasingly more scientists are curious about the knowledge of local people, including Indigenous people. And so, you know, a significant benefit is a better understanding of each other, and hopefully with that, a better respect. And there's this movement to actually look at an integration, or I prefer the term complementarity, looking at for where the complementarities, the similarities and the differences are between the two, with the idea that that if we have a richer array of sources, we've got a richer array of solutions for the future.